Sirius.com.
Criminal conspiracy. Bob Mueller will have to determine that.
Yeah, Congressman, you're right. There is plenty of evidence, but it's not against Mr. Trump. It's against lovebirds Lisa Page and Peter Strzok. Remember these doozies? This man cannot be president. I cannot believe Donald Trump is likely to be an actual serious candidate for president. They fully deserve to go and demonstrate the absolute bigoted nonsense of Trump. Donald is an enormous blank. Trump is a disaster. Joining me now, former Secret Service agent and host of Renegade Republican, Dan Bongino, and the author of The Russia Hoax, The Illicit Scheme to Clear Hillary Clinton and Frame Donald Trump, Fox News legal analyst Greg Jarrett. All right, so one of the things, guys, that hasn't been getting a lot of attention recently, and I've seen it covered on, I think Hannity, that's the only place I've seen it covered on, was that Christopher Steele was being paid by the FBI for many, many months and double-dipping, getting paid by the Hillary Clinton campaign and the DNC. And he was backdooring through the FBI with a man named Bruce Ohr. And Bruce Ohr's wife worked for Fusion GPS. And what does that tell you, Dan, about the operation that the FBI and the Clinton campaign were undertaking way, way, way early on in 2016?
Yeah, Jesse, this is a complicated case, but I break it down into three, let's say, sub-scandals. So Spygate's the mega scandal, there's three kind of sub-scandals. The one you're addressing here is what I call the information superhighway or the information laundering operation. And it's best summed up this way. When the FBI's source for most of the information used to spy on the Trump team, a guy by the name of Christopher Steele, paid by the Hillary team to generate this fake, spurious nonsense information against Trump, when he was discredited and deemed by the FBI, and I'm quoting, Jesse, the FBI here, when he was deemed not suitable for use as a source anymore because he was lying about his media contacts, they had to launder his information back into the FBI to use him again. So what did they do? They hired the wife of a DOJ official, Bruce Ohr, his wife Nellie at Fusion GPS, reconnected Steele right back into the DOJ, and basically, instead of laundering money, they laundered information. It's an absolute disgrace what happened to this president.
And Greg, someone made a great point the other day. You know how Dianne Feinstein is, it's been discovered that she had hired some Chinese mole, Chinese spy for many, many years. When the FBI got wind of it, they didn't send a bunch of FBI agents and spies to go look into Dianne Feinstein and try to entrap her. Instead, they gave her a defensive briefing and warned her about this guy. It's just so much different than the way the Trump situation was handled.
There's no fairness. There's no equivalency here. If you're a Democrat or a friend of Hillary, you get, you know, immunity, or you get off scot-free if you're remotely connected to Donald Trump. You get people like Robert Mueller and Andrew Weissman and his team of partisans coming after you with a vengeance and really abusing their positions of power. And that's part of the story of the Russia hoax. And you're right about Bruce Ohr and Christopher Steele. I mean, Steele's on the payroll of Hillary Clinton and the FBI. And when they fire him for being a liar, they continue to use him in violation of FBI regulations. They were devious about it. They had Bruce Ohr as a conduit. And the other amazing thing is, even after the president is elected, after he takes office, and for several months afterwards, they're still using Christopher Steele as a spy on Donald Trump, trying to verify the unverifiable dossier.
And now the big discussion is about this Trump Tower meeting, gentlemen. And the allegation is that this meeting between Don Jr. and this Russia woman amounted to some sort of conspiracy. They don't use the word collusion. I guess the legal terminology would be conspiracy, because information is the same thing as money. But I'm looking at it, and no information was ever given to the Trump team by Russia, yet the Hillary Clinton campaign paid for information from Kremlin sources. They just washed it through an intermediary, Christopher Steele. Isn't there a big difference between the Trump Tower meeting and the way the dossier was obtained, Dan?
You know, Jesse, you just hit the nail on the head. Jonathan Turley does a lot of work in this network, who is a very skilled lawyer and not partisan by any stretch, wrote a terrific piece saying just that. There is no possible way the Trump Tower meeting between Don Trump Jr., Manafort, and a couple of Russians, who, by the way, have very deep connections to both the Clintons and Fusion GPS, but that's another story, where no significant information on the Clintons is exchanged whatsoever. Granted, the meeting's a bad idea. Everybody acknowledges that, okay? There's no way that's a crime. But as you just said, Hillary Clinton, who actually paid Jesse, paid Kremlin-connected sources for actual information that was changed, that did change hands. There is no way that's not the crime. I mean, this is basic logic. The Democrats are going down a road here. I'll tell you, Jesse, they're walking right off a cliff, and I don't even think they know it. They're blinded by their hatred for Trump.
You know, the Federal Campaign Election Act specifically says, you can go to the FEC website, it says foreign nationals may volunteer their services in American political campaigns. And it information by itself is not a thing of value which would violate the law. What is a thing of value, and by the way, information not a thing of value, money is. Hillary Clinton paid money to Christopher Steele, making that a thing of value. So she clearly violated the law. In egregious cases like hers, it's a crime. But the Trump Tower meeting with Donald Trump Jr., that's not even remotely a crime.
But you know what, guys? I don't want to lock Hillary up. And you want to know why? I want her to run again. 2020, let's get a rematch. Guys, thank you very much. And everybody go get Greg's book. Candace Owens becomes the latest target of Antifa. She's here to react next.
This program is brought to you by Oral-B. Brush like a pro.
I've been making blades here.
People left out of control again, as two more conservatives were attacked this week by Antifa protesters. So watch what happened to Candace Owens and Charlie Kirk while they just wanted to have some breakfast in Philly on Monday. And don't forget, all of these vicious attacks have been encouraged by Democratic Congresswoman Maxine Waters.
If you see anybody from that cabinet in a restaurant, in a department store, at a gasoline station, you get out and you create a crowd. And you push back on them. And you tell them they're not welcome anymore, anywhere.
Joining me now, Communications Director for Turning Point USA, Candace Owens. So, Candace, do you hold Maxine Waters personally responsible for those people coming after you during breakfast?
I hold Maxine Waters responsible, as well as all of the politicians who did not speak out and say that this was wrong. They all remained silent because they are okay with this, because Antifa is their gang. Okay, they condone this behavior all the time. We're seeing that it's increasing. It's happened over and over again, and it's getting more vicious each time that it happens.
So you believe Antifa is indirectly linked to the Democratic Party leadership?
I bet if we did some digging, they would be directly linked to the Democratic leadership.
So you think maybe money is involved?
Yes.
Or you think people are involved, and maybe their mere silence publicly encourages this type of behavior, or even more so behind the scenes?
Absolutely. Just to, so people understand watching, this was 8 a.m. on a Monday morning. All of you guys were able to magically get out of work and dress in Antifa gear, or is this your job?
That's, how did they know you guys were having breakfast there?
So we actually were eating in the cafe, and four Antifa members walked in to eat. Like, they were not there to harass us, and when they recognized us, they kept looking back and texting on their phones. We didn't think they were actually going to assemble an army. We thought that they could actually get through breakfast and respectfully disagree on politics without saying anything to one another. But nope, they sent out the bat signal, and this is what happened.
So you guys had someone filming this encounter? Is that where the video's from?
That's correct. We actually had one of our production assistants were there because we were all about to go into a meeting, and we told her immediately start filming because, you know, if we don't have evidence, they were going to make up an entire story about what happened. So we needed to film every single moment, and we're glad we did.
You know, and the media is whining about the potential violence that is going to become them because of President Trump's rhetoric when there's actual violence taking place against Trump supporters. So when you're being attacked like that on the street, do you have an understanding that that's happening because of your effectiveness with the free thinker movement?
100% it is. They know exactly who I am, and they feel that they're losing control. They've had a major hold on Black thought for so long. I came around. I'm not the only one, but I think my approach and my style is a little bit different. My communication style is a little bit different, and I've been tremendously effective at getting people to consider different ideas, conservative positions, free markets, capitalism, and they don't like me.
So they see you as a threat. That's why they're harassing you.
100%. They view me as a threat. That's been very clear. It's why they show up when Charlie and I are on campus and we're speaking, and it's why Black Lives Matter protesters come up, because we know the real stats, we know what's going on, and we are going to make sure that every Black person in America is educated so that they know never to let the Democrat Party use us again to do their bidding.
I know you want to talk about something else we found interesting about police brutality against Black people. We have some startling statistics. In 2018, just already, 34 police officers have been shot and killed. Okay, now in 2018, I think so far, only 13 unarmed Black Americans have been killed by police. So there's a little bit of a discrepancy. Almost twice as many police officers have been killed than police have killed unarmed Black Americans. What do you make of those statistics?
Oh, I've known these statistics for a very long time, and that's why I attempt to re-educate the Black community about what's actually going on. A police officer is 18 and a half times more likely to be shot and killed by a Black man than the other way around, and that is why I vocally support the police. I understand what they're up against. I would never make an excuse and say it's okay when an unarmed Black man is shot by a police officer, but I do understand that those statistics are skewed in an effort to make Black people hate the police officers and do the bidding for the Democratic Party, which I refuse to do.
And some startling statistics came out from a Rasmussen poll. This isn't getting enough play. I think the Black support for President Trump was about 15% maybe a year and a half ago. And now, is it at 29%? Who do you attribute that to?
You know what? I think there have been so many people, Black conservatives, that are standing up and speaking out finally. We're definitely no longer afraid. And I think that I'm encouraged by seeing all of these YouTubers that speak out. And the one person we can credit for this is President Donald Trump. Thank you for all the tremendous work that you have done to get our community up off of their feet and to give us jobs again. You know, unemployment at an all-time low. You are the man, and we love you, and we will support you.
What about Kanye? Does Kanye get any credit for that?
Kanye gets the credit. He does. He broke the window on culture and made it okay for people to discuss it because so many people weren't paying attention. Kanye put on that MAGA hat. Thank you, Kanye West, number two.
All right, Donald with the help of Kanye. Candace, thank you very much.
Thanks for having me.
Up next, a professor attempts to school me on masculinity. And later, mini therapy horses. Ah.
No matter who rides point, there are over 10,000 Allstate agents riding sweep.
Ride while being chased by fighter jets. The suspect eventually crashing onto a nearby island, killing himself. The FBI is investigating his possible motive. In Charlottesville, Virginia, marking 1 year since a white nationalist rally turned deadly. This is the scene from last year when one person died, dozens of others were injured. Virginia's governor bracing for any possible protests, declaring a state of emergency, also ramping up the city's police presence. I'm Marianne Rafferty. Now back to Waters World.
What kind of characteristics do you think toxic masculinity manifests itself as?
Violence, aggression, sexual assault, whatever, the need to show dominance and power.
Would you admit that men maybe are physically superior?
No. Absolutely not. I bet I could beat you in any physical competition.
How much can you bench press?
More than you.
All across the country, toxic masculinity courses are taking colleges by storm. And now the new school here in New York will be holding a class called Male Melancholia, Crisis Masculinity, which focuses on the fall of white masculinity. Masha Tupitsin is a professor of film and gender studies who teaches the course, and she joins me now. All right, professor, what is toxic masculinity, first of all?
I would say there are different ways to describe it, but the way that I refer to it is to think about toxic masculinity as when masculinity has to kind of abuse its power in order to function.
How would I demonstrate on a day-to-day basis toxic masculinity?
Well, I mean, I think that's a complicated question, but on a daily basis, it would be in your relationships with other people, in your relationships with women in the workplace, and the way that you relate to your own power in the workplace.
Just by being a jerk and offensive and imposing my will on other people.
Yeah, or even negotiating that imposition of will on other people, right? This idea that you have to kind of stoke my ego or behave a certain way to get ahead.
Okay, so white masculinity is now a problem. There's a downfall among white males. How so?
Well, I'm not saying that there's a downfall. I don't think there's a loss of power, although men are always lamenting their loss of power.
How are we doing?
This constant idea, even someone like President Trump, who's always lamenting sort of the good old days, or a show like Mad Men, which is always focusing on this kind of loss of supremacy that men once held. So that narrative has been going on.
So when Donald Trump says, make America great again, mm-hmm. what is he trying to say? That we want to return to the good old days where white men ruled the earth?
Yeah, and still rule the earth. But that's being destabilized. And so there's this constant kind of narrative of mourning and loss about what's been lost. But what really needs to happen...
But couldn't the president just be saying, well, I want to go back to the 80s, where the economy was roaring and we were doing great.
And when he was the king.
I mean, couldn't that be what he's saying? Maybe not.
But either way, it's self-referential.
White males, maybe more about let's go back to when America was strong and powerful and the economy was great.
And it was a patriarchy that no one questioned.
But is he saying there was a patriarchy that no one questioned?
But no one has to say that. I think there isn't any debate anymore whether sexism is real. I think even the disbelievers are now believers.
So you think when Trump says make America great again, mm-hmm. he wants to go back to the time when sexism was good?
Well, when it was good and it certainly wasn't questioned and people were afraid to question it.
But how do you know that?
Let me just finish. So part of what I think is important about the Me Too movement or the Time's Up movement is that it's making everyone question what the effects of masculinity have been, right? It's making everyone have that conversation and to think about how that, how sexism has been totally normalized just on an everyday
level. But how
level.
Do you know, though? Because you don't know.
Well, I am a woman, and sexism is part of the daily fabric of all women's
lives. Okay, but you don't know when Trump says, make America great again, he's talking about wanting to bring back sexism.
Now we're having a conversation about mind reading as opposed to interpretation.
Well, but you brought up that he wanted
because
to go back to
those
days.
Because these are very old narratives, and
I
they don't just
up.
Refer to national politics. National politics also consists of race and class and gender. It's a kind of package deal, right? When you're talking about nation building, you're talking about a lot of other multidimensional things.
Okay, well, I did not take that from what the president said when he uses that slogan. Mm-hmm. I guess you're
so
interpreting
it differently.
I
didn't come here just to discuss his slogan.
Right, so what do white men need to do in America now? How can we improve, in your opinion?
Well, to me, the crisis is really about this lack of responsibility and this lack of self-interrogation, right? That's really what, I mean, etymologically, the root of crisis means this point at which change must come.
But what do you
so
mean?
So either the change can come or it won't. But what needs to happen is that men start doing some of the work and interrogation around masculinity, as opposed to all these other sort of special interest groups.
Okay,
like
so let's just take
studies.
It step by step. I'm a man. Mm-hmm. I'm a white man. Mm-hmm. What do I need to ask myself, or what do I need to address internally about my white male
Well, I would say two things to start with. So one is, what kind of privileges have I inherited because of my whiteness and my masculine, straight masculinity, let's say?
White privilege.
White privilege, but it also has to do with masculinity. So I would ask, like, and we all have to ask that question. What privileges do we come in the world with, and do we abuse those privileges?
Okay, so you want white men, I'll just take a step, you want white men to recognize that they have certain advantages by being born a white straight male.
Yes, that they use.
And they want, and you and I, as a white straight male, should be more conscious of my privileges when I go walk around in everyday society.
You should be, but most likely you won't be because you don't have to. I mean, that's sort of the argument that I'm making. Most people are only conscious because they're disenfranchised in some way, right? So they're aware of how the dominant power works and how their own lives function. And people who have dominant power don't have to ask those questions. Okay. So the questions that men have to ask themselves are the same questions that all kind of people that are struggling for consciousness and liberation and justice need to ask, so that the world can be better
for
everyone.
What about a guy in Minnesota who's making, you know, $20 an hour, his really tough job, he's got a family he's trying to support, and the economy's not working for him, and things are tough. How does he have white privilege?
Well, you didn't specify that he is white,
well,
so I don't
I know
that he has white privilege. He still is a, even if he doesn't have economic privilege, right?
I'm he not still saying, has racial privilege.
He still has racial privilege. Okay. He still has masculine privilege. He can walk into a bar, right, and behave a certain way because he's a man, that he might not be able to walk into his job and behave that way, right? We all kind of negotiate power in different ways. So just because you're not powerful in one setting, you can still be powerful and privileged
in another
setting.
When I walk into a bar as a straight white male, am I being too confident when I walk into the bar?
Well, I don't know
should
how you
go
are
in
when
a
you
more
walk
humble
into a
way?
Bar. I just know that men can behave a certain way in public settings and in bars that is different from women. I mean, this is the case for everyone, right? There are codes that we're all following. Even if we just go to work and we don't behave a
like
certain way, we can
be loud and obnoxious, and I can buy people drinks,
aggressive.
And I can flirt with people. Is that what you're saying? And
you
women can't do that?
Well, they might do it, but they pay a different price for that.
Okay.
Even just on the level of, you might not be seen as someone desperate if you're a single man that walks into a bar.
Right.
Whereas if a woman walks into a bar and she's single, that is perceived as a very different kind of social gesture.
Okay. And then lastly, so what was the other question I'm supposed to ask myself as a straight white man?
Well, you've interrupted me so many times and now I can't remember.
I guess that's probably my toxic masculinity.
Probably.
All right, Professor, thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.
Coming up, Diamond and Silk take on Rosie O'Donnell. Can't wait for this. Violence in Chicago out of control. Last weekend, 74 people were shot across the city. 12 of them were killed. President Trump's expressed deep concern over the escalating violence, but Rahm Emanuel, the city's ultra-liberal mayor, told him to butt out.
You recently declared Chicago schools a Trump-free zone.
The city of Chicago, yeah.
The whole thing?
The whole thing, man.
What does that
Trump
mean?
I don't know if I've ever thought this, but I did yesterday. Can you actually take away a president's security clearance?
Rahm, someone's got to control your city. It's totally out of control. Almost 4,000 people have been murdered in Chicago since you took office. Look at those statistics. Here with reaction, Diamond and Silk. All right, ladies, what do you think about Rahm and the just massive amount of violence going on there?
You know, first of all, let me just say this here. I think that the president should send in the feds because you can't have this level of violence, turf wars, and drugs flowing through that city without somebody being paid a kickback, paddy whack, give a dog a bone to turn a blind eye.
That's
so
right.
The first thing he should do is send in the feds and then send in the National Guards to clean up that place. You know, I think it's so sad that we have black on black crime, people getting crossed in the crossfires of bullets and being killed for no reason. Innocent blood. And where is the Al Sharptons, the Jesse Jackson, the NAACP?
And the NFL players.
And the NFL players.
Yeah.
To kneel kneel and talk to our brothers, that's our right. black brothers, and tell them to stop killing each other. Mm-hmm. Where are they at? They're nowhere to be found. But if this was a this was what happened to white people, uh-huh. oh, here come everybody going to the situation to see how we can solve it.
That's
it
right.
is time for us to pay attention to what's going on. What's going on? This is black on black crime. Mm-hmm. This is our black men killing other black men and innocent people getting crossing the crossfires, and it needs to stop.
And this is also a clear example of what Democrat-ran cities look like. You have individuals like this particular mayor that would prefer to fund sanctuary cities instead of fund individuals to help clean up the city.
That's
yeah,
right.
It's a national disgrace, and the mainstream media is not even holding Rahm Emanuel accountable. A lot of other news stories this past week and last couple weeks, the media has just completely buried. So the other day, the president goes down to Florida and announces a massive increase in jobs as a result of his policies down there. We also saw the remains of the Korean War soldiers returned. And look at this here. Pence comes out to receive the remains in a very somber and important and historical ceremony. And look at the networks. ABC News yeah. didn't even give it 30 seconds. CBS didn't cover it. NBC Nightly News didn't cover it. MSNBC didn't take it live. I mean, it's just completely ridiculous the way that they're burying these types of stories. And then you had another really poignant moment where the president stops his motorcade after one of his events and gets out and starts greeting firefighters and shaking their hands. It was just one of those really touching presidential moments that the media, if it had been Barack Obama, would have picked up and led with on the nightly news. But if it's this president, they don't even cover it at all.
You know, unlike other people that probably didn't vote for the president, we voted for this man because That's of this right. reason. We know his heart. He loves people. And that should be shown on national news.
That's
but they
right.
don't do that because they like to disrespect him and disparage him. That's the kind of narrative that they like to run on this president. Instead of giving him praise for the good things that he's doing things that we've never seen done in our country before. Mm. But they don't want to give him the credit for that. What they want to do is stay on their own stinking, thinking narrative.
That's right.
And that's why we ignore them. We really appreciate this president for everything that he is doing for this country.
That's
and
right.
that's why I tell you, when you bet on Trump, when you vote for Trump,
yes.
you never can go wrong with that.
That's right.
Yes.
And we love our president so, so much that we wish he could be the president forever.
Yeah.
You have to change the yes. Constitution for that one,
well,
ladies.
Well, let's get started with it.
Okay. So Rosie O'Donnell doesn't want him to be president forever, wants him impeached immediately. She did a round of media interviews. Here she is on a cable network.
I believe that Trump is loathed in America, that people are embarrassed and ashamed of who he is, and that come election day, we're going to stand up at the polls and let him know. And unless he goes in and has the Russians kind of fix it like he did last time in 2016, you know, we're going to see him gone.
Ladies, what do you think about Rosie O'Donnell making a comeback?
Well, see, Rosie don't realize that the American people also feel dislike and disdain for her, too.
That's right.
And maybe she should do what she told everybody she was going to do is go. Instead of her singing in front of the White House, what she should have been doing was sitting in a jailhouse
uh-huh.
for violations of giving too much campaign contribution to all of these people under alias names.
That's right.
That's what she should be worried yeah. about.
I forgot about that. I forgot
House.
About that. Yeah,
you
I don't think.
About that was, see, I remembered it.
Yeah, right. you know what? You have a better memory than I do, and I don't think the feds are probably going to make her a priority. All right, I'll see you guys next week. Up next, Greg Gutfeld and I share our favorite Trump tweets of the year. Be right back.
My name is J.D. Vance. I took a...
President Trump, known for his tough tweets and stinging comments about liberals, so we thought we'd highlight a few of our favorites from 2018. Here with his picks, host of The Greg Gutfeld Show and author of the new book, The Gutfeld Monologues.
What do you think of my shirt?
Gutfeld.
See,
I love that shirt.
I knew what you were up to. You were going to have me on to talk about Trump so you could beat me in the ratings on Saturday tonight. And I thought, I'm going to counteract your deviousness, which is, by the way, brilliant, to do a Trump segment with me to beat me on Saturday night. So I thought I'd wear this shirt.
I like it. It needs a collar. Everything else is great, though.
So I could flip it up.
All
right. By the way, I look great, don't I?
You do look great. Did you just come back from the gym?
I went to. That's where I got this idea. But I've been working out a lot just for you, Jesse.
Yeah, you look fantastic.
I have to, now that you're on the show, I have to keep up. I have to start watching my weights. I might even dye my hair.
Well, you don't need to. You don't need to. You look fantastic, and everybody knows it. We are going to read some Trump tweets.
Yes.
Here is my favorite one. You ready?
Yes.
The Red Hen restaurant should focus more on cleaning its filthy canopies, doors, and windows. Badly needs a paint job. Rather than refusing to serve a fine person like Sarah Huckabee Sanders, I always had a rule. If a restaurant's dirty on the outside, it's dirty on the inside.
It is one of the best because the specifics. Filthy canopies. That should be the name of a boat.
Filthy canopies. You know, he was a restaurateur, and he's got all these famous places all over the country.
Yeah.
He does take pride in the cleanliness and the display and the presentation of a restaurant. And nothing is worse than calling a restaurant filthy.
It's also memorable. People, when they think of the restaurant as dirty, they can't get that out of their head.
Yeah, because you're a very picky eater. You'd never go to the Red Hen.
I eat nothing but raw pigeon.
That's disgusting. I punched a pigeon once. Didn't need it, though. All right, Greg, read one of your favorite Trump tweets from this year.
While Washington, Michigan was a big success, Washington, D.C. just didn't work. Everyone's talking about the fact that the White House correspondents' dinner was a very big, boring bust. The so-called comedian really bombed. Greg Gutfeld should host next year at Pete Hegseth.
I wonder why you picked that tweet.
I don't know. You know, the thing is, it's really weird to wake up in the morning and have a lot of people going, hey, did you look on Twitter?
Yeah,
and
your phone blows up.
Yeah, and I go, oh, that's good. But, you know, I was very touched, and I think he's right, but I don't know if I do the gig.
Why not?
You know what? You never leave the gig better off than you were before.
Yeah, I see what you mean.
It just doesn't help.
It doesn't help. And your jokes probably would go over all of their heads.
I think you're right.
Your humor is a little too highbrow for this week. All right, one of my other favorites from this year. Here's this. Crazy Joe Biden's trying to act like a tough guy. Actually, he is weak, both mentally and physically. And yet he threatens me for the second time with physical assault. He doesn't know me. But he would go down fast and hard, crying all the way. Don't threaten people, Joe. What a tough guy.
He is a natural at this. This is an art form. Don't threaten people, Joe. Should be a t-shirt. He's fantastic.
Yeah, like yours.
Good at this.
I know. You should make him one. I like that he's going to go down fast and hard, like Trump's been training. Those two guys. All right, go ahead. What's your next one?
My next one. The media are good news fire extinguishers. At Greg Gutfeld, the five.
I actually agree with that one. That was a very good line. And you just said that a couple days ago.
Yes, I did. And he quoted me. So I thought I'd do this. This is trying to make it all about me and the Greg Gutfeld show, which will be on in less
than
90 minutes.
I finally met someone more shameless than myself.
Yes. Wow. It's true, and we're both here at the same table.
That's a double
dose of shamelessness.
Okay, here we go. Next one. This is the last one for me. Alec Baldwin, who calls him Alex, whose dying mediocre career was saved by his impersonation of me on SNL, now says playing DGT was agony for him. Alex, it was also agony for those who were forced to watch. You were terrible. Bring back Daryl Hammond, much funnier and a far greater talent.
You know what's great about this?
What's that?
The mistake he makes is on purpose, Alex Baldwin.
You think that was not a typo?
Yeah, it was on purpose. It was just another little dig. I don't even know the guy's name.
Yeah.
It's Alex. Alec. Who doesn't matter? He's washed up.
That's right. Like Max Gutfeld.
Yes, exactly.
Hell of a guy.
There might be one of those.
Probably. What's your last one here?
The Gutfeld Monologues is the greatest book ever written, with the exception of The Art of the Deal, which is also a great gift for all the ages.
Wait a second.
Nah, it hasn't happened. That tweet has not happened.
That was a fake tweet.
I just made that up. It's fake tweet. I made up a tweet.
You're perpetuating fake news on Waterworld.
I'm planting the thought in the president's head to tweet this, and then my book sales will skyrocket.
But you want a link in the tweet.
I got to beat Janine, and I got to beat Jarrett. Greg Jarrett and Janine.
Listen, as long as everybody sells 1, 2, 3, we're all fine.
Exactly.
We don't compete on the show. At all. All right, so other favorite moments that I've selected, Greg's selections were really not up to par.
That's true.
One of my favorite moments was when the president was with Kim Jong-un, and just a great embarrassing moment for the North Korean leader. Watch this.
Very nice. Getting a good picture of everybody, so we look nice and handsome and thin.
Beautiful.
Perfect.
Oh. And then they pan to his big, fat, not handsome, not thin face.
Don't be so, you know, this could be a good relationship.
Am I destroying the North Korean-American relationship?
You could be undermining. People are very sensitive about their weight. I am.
Greg, you were just bragging before we got out here about how
Atkins.
Trim you look.
That's because I've been doing Atkins, eating those chocolate shakes.
Okay.
That Rob Lowe's selling now.
That's exactly.
Rob Lowe's old.
I thought it was beets. I thought you ate all those beets.
No. Super beets?
Not the super beets?
No super beets.
All right.
Yet.
All right.
Well, it looks delightful.
They are very.
Call me Super Beats.
My favorite moment, let's just skip to the last one. This was the president at a rally, just razzle dazzle, talking about who he calls Pocahontas.
It's a lot easier. Let's say I'm debating Pocahontas, right? I promise you I'll do this. I will take, you know, those little kits they sell on television for $2? I'm going to get one of those little kits. And in the middle of the debate, when she proclaims that she's of Indian heritage, because her mother said she has high cheekbones, and we will very gently take that kit and we will slowly toss it, hoping it doesn't hit her and injure her arm, even though it only weighs probably 2 ounces. And we will say, I will give you $1 million to your favorite charity, paid for by Trump, if you take the test and it shows you're an Indian.
He wants Warren so bad in 2020.
This is what has changed about politics is that these campaign rallies are basically improvisational comedy routines.
Yeah.
That he really enjoys the crowd. He's a comedian who's fallen in love with going out and hearing the laughter. So he just does this stuff. And sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't.
It's like an hour 20 stand-up
exactly.
In front of 30,000.
Exactly.
So tell everybody the most important reason why to purchase Gutfeld Monologues.
If you like the monologues, they're in here, finally, in one place. And I annotate them and tell you what I was thinking when I wrote it, what I got wrong and what I got right. But it's pretty
easy. You got things wrong in the
monologues? It's hard to believe. You know, I actually admit that I'm wrong.